In Argentina, Dusha was a hero. In England, he was a hitman sent from Buenos Aires to do a job on Beckham. Deep-seated passions and prejudices had resurfaced. This was the latest chapter in a 40-year saga. Two nations, England and Argentina, locked in a vicious and vindictive battle.
I think that the England-Argentina fixture is probably the way that the England-Germany fixture is looked upon.
Now for Beckham, it's a red card for David Beckham.
Oh, no.
There's always been a, I wouldn't say a bad blood, but a bit of an history between the countries, and not just on footballing field.
For an Argentinian person, the Falkland issue was all the time. All the time in our mind.
He's given a penalty to Argentina and a yellow card to David Seaman.
It's a mouth-watering prospect of having the chance to play them again. The desire and the eager to have revenge is burning bright, so to speak.
In 1966, Argentina arrived in England for the World Cup finals. It was to be a notorious and unpleasant visit, which ironically got off to a regal and dignified start.
I welcome all our visitors and feel sure that we shall be seeing some fine football.
The Argentinians arrived with a reputation for playing tough, aggressive football.
When in 66, everyone knew what kind of team they were labelled as the dirtiest team in the World Cup.
They could be sinister.
The late tackles.
A lot of aggression in their play.
The first thing was that you didn't get anywhere near the goals.
They, at times, scythed you, you know.
If you knocked the ball past them and it looked as though it was going to be danger, they would stop you.
Ratzin, I remember the captain, who was always disputing decisions, always going in late on tackles.
Led by Antonio Ratten, nicknamed the General, the skillful Argentinians were among the tournament's favourites. But like other South Americans, they believed the football authorities' clampdown on their physical game was designed to benefit European teams. Their suspicions seemed justified when German referee Rudolf Kreitland took charge of their quarter-final clash with England. Although English players committed almost twice as many fouls as their opponents, Kreitland booked four South Americans and not one Englishman in the first 30 minutes. Ratten was incensed.
Ratten, the captain, thought, in South America, you know, I'm the captain, and if I want to speak to the referee, I show him my band, and my band says that you have to give me your attention while I speak to you, you know, and that was, I think, his attitude.
There were 75,000 fanatical English fans, so the first 12 or 15 minutes were really difficult, and the referee was giving every decision to England. I told the referee I wanted a translator. He said I made a rude gesture, but all I did was show my captain's armband and ask for an interpreter.
Exasperated by Ratten's constant harassment, the referee sent him off 10 minutes before half-time. But Ratten refused to go. In front of a baying English crowd, the World Cup ground to a halt for over 10 minutes.
And who's that running off our team, going to Juan Carlos Lorenzo.
Quarter final of the World Cup, two games away from the World Cup final. And to do something like that, imagine if Bobby Moore did something like that. What a catastrophe, you know, he'd be berated for the rest of his life and pilloried for actually letting his country down. And there's a goal!
England's Geoff Hurst scored the only goal of the game to seal the Argentinians' fate.
There's an appeal by the Argentinians.
We were lucky, I feel, to come through that match without any bad injuries. There were a few scratches and bruises and things like that.
And the whistle has gone. England have won it. England are in the semi-final of the World Cup, and Argentina are out.
England's manager, Alf Ramsey, fanned the flames by calling the Argentinians animals. The insult was to cause deep and long-lasting offence throughout South America.
They tried to change shirts with Gonzalez, and Alf came running over and said, "Oh, you're not going to change shirts with that animal." He wouldn't let me exchange. He was very angry, Alf.
He didn't like the way the Argentinians played. He didn't like their attitude. He didn't like their players. He thought some of their displays, you know, didn't have any part in football. He just came out openly and honestly and said they were animals.
While Alf Ramsey used his post-match interviews to insult Argentina once again, the threat of violence followed the referee and the players down the tunnel.
Well, they were banging on the door, and there was a couple of the lads said, "Well, let them in," you know. They were fuming.
The general feeling was that we were cheated. As simple as that. We were cheated by the referee. This is why when the Argentina team come back to Argentina, they were received like heroes, absolute heroes, and Ratin, the number one hero.
The Argentinian players returned home, victims of European conspiracy and English arrogance. Branded as animals, Argentinians craved revenge, and they did not have long to wait. Their victims, though, were not English, but a team of unsuspecting Scots. Glasgow Celtic squared up to Racing Club of Buenos Aires in the 1967 World Club Championship. After winning at home, Celtic ventured into enemy territory.
Well, we played Racing Club from South America, who'd won the championship. First time they'd won it for quite a number of years. And a real tough game, a really good team, and a real tough encounter.
I remember when we went out onto the pitch, the whole thing just took us by storm. You know, it was pandemonium. It was just a cacophony of sound and noise. What will that green signal turn
to blue? Then, of course, a disaster happened before the game because something was thrown from the crowd, which hit Ronnie, the goalkeeper, Ronnie Simpson, and he couldn't play. That was upsetting for all of us, that off-field activities had taken over.
When they came to Racing, we destroyed them all over the pitch. Celtic were a very brave team, but we made them really angry. So angry that they started playing badly.
There was kicking, jersey pulling, hair tugging, spitting. You name it, everything, all the things that should go on in football went on.
They didn't seem to want to play the game. All they wanted to do was to disrupt it, and the fouls in the game were absolutely incredible, and they were making the usual gestures about things going across your throat and Buenos Aires. Oof. It no longer was football, it was more a contest of who was going to survive.
When some football did get played, Racing levelled the tie in Buenos Aires and went on to win the decider. But they were spiteful games, with six players sent off in familiar and ugly scenes.
I think it was when Bobby Lennox was going off that the Argentinian who was getting sent off with him, he just refused to go off. And then within seconds, the police were on with batons hitting him over the head. And I always remember saying to myself, "Well, big man, if you're getting sent off, just go off.
Well, we lost four. We had various bits and pieces missing. I had a cut eyebrow myself, I remember, and a fair bit of spittle removed from various bits of hair, and very wounded pride, and broken hearts, you could say as well.
A bruising battle had been won, but the bitter war raged on. In the following year's World Club Championship, Manchester United faced Estudiantes of Buenos Aires. Nobby Styles, nicknamed the Assassin, and still hated to this day in Argentina, was sent off in Buenos Aires for mere dissent. But in Manchester, as United lost the tie, George Best and Jose Medina kept up traditions with a full-blooded fight. By now, bad blood was spilling over from one game to another. And next was a trip to Buenos Aires by the English national team.
I think I could probably say that it's the most intimidating atmosphere I've ever played in.
I don't know if it was an English thing or a footballing thing, but they really hated the British, if you like.
With Argentina in the grip of a brutal dictatorship, it was an intimidating Buenos Aires that England travelled to in 1977. Despite the presence of the aptly named Argentinian defender, Daniel Killer, the game was supposed to be a friendly, a warm-up for the following year's World Cup finals.
Well, we like arrived in the big banners saying we are not animals and go on the English and things like that.
I think I could probably say that it's the most intimidating atmosphere I've ever played in. There was the army walking around with tear gas on their backs, and there's Alsatians everywhere, and they're all got machine guns strapped to them, and you think, well, is this a football match or what is it, you know?
I can't understand, to be honest with you, to this day, where I actually went and played a friendly there, because it was anything but, and the welcoming party weren't very friendly neither.
But this Boca Juniors crowd has got quite a history, and the crowd here have been known to be more hostile than in any other stadium in Argentina.
Yes, I remember the game. I played the game. And the game was tough, very physical.
So Argentina get the game in motion. Number 10, Bocini, out to Bertoni.
No era un amistoso, no es un partido más argentino.
No, it wasn't a friendly match. It was much more than just a football match. There's no such thing as a friendly between England and Argentina. I see myself as a nationalist, proud to play for my country.
Diego, Bertoni, nice skill. He made a lot of that, Bertoni.
They scored quite early on from a free kick, if I remember. I think it was Bertoni who bent it over the top of the wall.
Bertoni chips it.
But then in the second half, it turned a little bit nasty, and there were one or two tasty tackles flying around.
I'd had a brush with Bertoni in the first half. He was there.
This is Bertoni. Always danger when he's on the ball. And was that a foul by Cherry?
And that probably caught him a couple of times with tackles. And then later on in the game, he just turned round and whacked me one, really. Unfortunately, out there, the politics are that the referee sent us both off. I don't think he dared to just send an Argentine player off, to be honest with you.
Sadly, the history repeating itself. Ratin sent off against England in 66, and now both sides are down to 10 men.
Just as the game lost two players, Trevor Cherry had lost two front teeth.
He
didn't do anything wrong. I had the ball and he tackled me from behind, so I punched him. There was a lot of blood on my hand, and Cherry had two teeth knocked out. I hit him with my left hand. You can still see the scar.
If fight fans were looking forward to a World Cup rematch, they were to be disappointed. England's failure to qualify for the 1978 finals confirmed that its football star was fading fast. Now it was Argentina's turn to shine, to lift the trophy on home soil. And success was to put some of Argentina's top players in the international shop window.
After the World Cup, my club, like every other club in Argentina, and not only in that time, but at this time right now, nothing has changed. They were in big, big financial trouble. So it was obvious that I was going to be sold. There were a few rumors at the time, Spain, Italy, very especially. Never England, of course. And suddenly it was this guy, Keith working show in Argentina, saying that he wanted to buy not only me, but Ricky as well.
It was as easy as that. I saw him next day, and within 10 minutes, he'd put his the pen to paper, and he was a Tottenham player. For a very small sum, really, because I think we got him at the end of it all for about £320,000, and that included a signing on fee for Ozzy.
We were cheated. Keith working show could have given a little bit more, but he was a little bit mean. I don't put that. Whatever happened to
Leon Trotsky? Suddenly, Argentinian footballers were welcome in England. Spurs fans fell in love with Villa, and particularly Ardiles. Mimicking their Argentinian counterparts, they gave the players a ticker tape welcome to White Hart Lane at the start of the 1978 season.
Well, it was headlines everywhere, and it caught everybody's imagination.
Well, the big majority was very, very welcome. Wherever we play, we just won the World Cup with Ricky, and apart from that, we were completely different. We were the first foreigners.
With the skillful Ardiles and Villa in his squad, Keith Birkinshaw began to build a Spurs team that played attractive and successful football. It was the start of a journey leading to the Twin Towers of Wembley for the 1981 FA Cup final.
This was the mecca of football. You can talk about the Maracana Stadium in Brazil and all this, but Ozzy and Ricky, they knew about Wembley, and this is where they wanted to play a game of football.
Just 15 years after Antonio Ratten's controversial sending off and Alf Ramsey calling the Argentinians animals, Ardiles and Villa took their place at the self-styled home of football, hailed as heroes of the English game and the architects of Spurs' success.
Everybody saw it as something that was connected to Ricky and Ozzy, and of course it was picked up by the media and picked up by the fact that we made a record that sort of eulogised Ozzy going to Wembley. Ozzy's going to Wembley, his knees have gone all trembly. Come on you Spurs, come on you Spurs,
come on you Spurs. And the 100th FA Cup final is now underway. Oh, he's turned the ball, the shot, pushed away by Corrigan.
Well, I mean, Ozzy just had this love affair with the Tottenham fans. You know, for a foreign player to come into the country and have the FA Cup record just made for him, basically. And it was his voice that sold it and put it to number one in the charts. It was an amazing situation, really.
It was sort of like a tidal wave that just got bigger and stronger, and the only thing that worried me at the time was it was becoming so big that we were forgetting about the football a little bit.
No, I never liked it so much, that's all.
Well, Ransom Knight with an early ball, played in there.
Having put his team into the lead, Manchester City's Tommy Hutchison levelled the score with a second-half own goal. But he wasn't the only player having a bad game.
Ricky Villa was substituted after 65 minutes.
He'd had a poor game, I felt. Everything seemed to have got on top of him. Was a very emotional type, was Ricky. Ozzy was a more cold type of person and take things like that in his stride, but Ricky, I think it had got to him a little bit, and he had a very poor game, and I took him off, and he wasn't very happy.
What about that for a sad and sorrowful sight? Ricky Villa, World Cup man with Argentina, thought today could be one of the most memorable days of his life.
It was my dream to play at Wembley and to win the cup. But my dream was turning into a nightmare. I felt I'd let my teammates down, and I was very upset on my way back to the dressing room.
When I got into the dressing room after the match, he had a few tears, but I said, look, forget about what's going on today. You're playing on Thursday, and I want you to make sure that you're going to do the business, and we're going to win that match.
Archibald saved Villa!
And Villa did do the business, in emphatic style. With two goals, his cup final rehabilitation was complete.
He scored a goal in the first half, and then he scored the one that a lot of people say is the best that's ever been scored at Wembley, which was terrific, really, for everybody concerned.
And he can really stab them, going all the way! Two goals in the game for Villa, and Spurs are back in the league.
That made Rick, I mean, that was, without a shadow of a doubt, his happiest moment in football.
Our dealers, the man who dreamt about winning at Wembley, said this, after the World Cup final, was his most important game.
From my own experience, it was the nicest thing that I did in England. To win the 1981 FA Cup was really, really wonderful.
To the Tottenham supporters.
But within a year of Ardiles and Villa's day of glory at Wembley, their lives were plunged into crisis. With Argentina's invasion of the Falkland Islands in April 1982, the country was at war with England.
At the time, it was a terrible time for me. It was the worst time in my life, probably. I was absolutely torn between the two countries I love.
I could not believe, I could not believe that the people of Argentina were fighting against us.
FA Cup final with Spurs was the pinnacle of Ozzy Ardiles and Ricky Villa's club careers. They had become England's most popular and famous Argentinians. It was a status they enjoyed until April 1982. When Britain and Argentina went to war.
Argentina invades Falklands, 3 emergency cabinet meetings today. Ministers claim we couldn't have stopped them. The Navy's on the way, a task force is assembling. In Argentina, they're dancing in the streets.
Britain may have been going to a war over islands that many of its people knew nothing and cared less about. But for Argentinians, sovereignty of Las Malvinas was a powerful and emotional issue.
Well, you're always disappointed when a war breaks out anywhere in the world, whoever it's between, because you know people are going to lose lives.
Terrible. All my world came down in a very big manner.
I know that I had hate mail sent to me, and one guy threatened to shoot me.
Argentina going to war with Britain was always going to cause problems for Ardiles and Villa. But the military junta's timing was particularly unhelpful. It invaded the Falklands just hours before they were to play in an FA Cup semi-final.
Ozzy and Ricky start talking to me about the Falklands War. I said, what are you talking about? They said, well, we've had calls from Argentina all night about us declaring war on Britain in the Falklands. And they were all excited about this. And I'm thinking to myself, well, should I play these two?
FA Cup semi-final day at Villa Park. And here come second division Leicester City.
However, I thought about it, and they did play against Leicester, and the Leicester fans gave them hell.
And Osvaldo Ardiles of Argentina is a man clearly under a lot of pressure. Quite apart from the tension of a semi-final, and that's severe enough, it's a weekend when his mind must be full of his country's activities at the moment in the Falkland Islands.
You have to put in consideration that for an Argentinian person, the Falkland issue was all the time in our mind. I always remember, I mean, growing up and so on, and always remembering and repeating, well, the Falklands are Argentina all the time.
It was disappointing that the Leicester fans, like, they took, they didn't exactly take to Ozzy when he had the ball at his feet.
There were a few times during the war for Las Malvinas when the crowd booed me, but I didn't think they were being really hostile. I tried to imagine what would happen to an English player in the same situation in Argentina. He wouldn't even make it onto the pitch.
That's in keeping with what a lot of people think.
I feel that there are hours, and for me as well, I am very happy that there are hours right now, and I hope that all this problem can be arranged in the peaceful way.
Driven by patriotism, politics and sport collided, and Ardiles was caught in the crossfire of two warring countries.
If I was in England, I would say something nice. I was Argentina, they would accuse me of something. If I was in Argentina saying, well, by the way, I like to play golf in Britain, they would say, well, I am a traitor and so on. It was absolutely terrible.
While Ricky Villa remained in London, Ozzy Ardiles joined up with the Argentinian squad to prepare for the World Cup finals in Spain. And as war continued to rage in the South Atlantic, the prospect of another venomous World Cup clash with the hated English loomed large.
At that time, the Falklands War was at its highest, and we were not popular, to be honest, at that time. Spain went towards, you know, the Argentinian philosophy and against England. I think that was a difficult time for us in 82.
Towards the end of the beating, the police were being egged on by Spanish chanting Argentina, Argentina. Down the street, the anti-British feeling which has been simmering here came to the surface in reply to British goading from the safety of the Bernabeu Stadium.
To progress and possibly meet Argentina in the final, England had to beat the hostile Spanish. But they failed, playing out a goalless draw before packing their bags and heading home, a defeated nation.
And it's Robson, and it's wide. Keegan! Robson! Well, the picture tells the story.
But for England, defeat in football was compensated by Britain's victory in war. On the Falklands, Argentina's young conscripts had had enough.
At about 6 p.m. London time, the white flag was hoisted in Gritvicum beside the Argentine flag, and shortly afterwards the Argentine forces there surrendered to British forces.
Now Argentina's only hope of victory lay on the football pitch. Just 2 days after surrendering in the Falklands and looking to the haunted Maradona for inspiration, they faced Brazil. But as with Ratten in 1966 and Beckham in 98, Maradona hit the headlines for all the wrong reasons.
That is the end of Diego Maradona's World Cup. Well, this is sensational, and what a tragic end to Maradona's World Cup. And this must be the most tragic moment of his career so far.
Argentina live, well, one thing is the politics, of course, and the other thing that Argentina live for is football. And suddenly the two things kind of collapse. So there were terrible times, terrible, terrible times.
Time was no healer in the vengeful England-Argentina conflict.
Argentina, Argentina, watch it, let you lose the war.
Emotions continued to run high when the two countries faced each other again in the quarterfinals of the 1986 World Cup in Mexico. But the Argentinian people also wanted revenge for Las Malvinas, to see the stuffy English beaten, and they expected one player in particular to deliver the killer punch.
Well, the build-up to the game against Argentina in 86 was all about Maradona. I mean, Maradona was my favourite player, a lot of favourite players, and, you know, just for the very fact that you're playing against Maradona was very special.
We knew it was going to be a problem. I mean, Maradona is a problem. He's a problem to any team. That's why they won the World Cup.
It was a very charged game. The atmosphere was electric. A lot of people, including me, were very, very worried about what could happen in the stadium and in the streets and so on.
Fears about violence proved well placed. Trouble flared as English and Argentinian fans fought their personal battles on the terraces.
Unbelievable. I mean, even I, with my experience, you know, could feel it, could feel the passion and the tension in the air. There wasn't any doubt about that. And in the warm-up and the beginning of the match, and, you know, when the referee blew the whistle and the first ball, and after that, it was just a big, high-tempo match.
It was a match in which Maradona took center stage and used the hand of God to exact divine retribution.
I can remember watching it and then and thinking, hang on, what's happened there?
Shelton is back to it. It's Maradona's goal.
He went up for the header and he stuck his hand up like you see as clear on the television. On the day, I remember it clearly. Everybody remembers it clearly.
And fortune has turned sour on England.
It looked okay to me. It looked like he'd used his head. I started to cheer, and my father said, "Shut up, he used his hand." When we watched the replay, I saw that yes, it was his hand.
In Argentina, a carterista is a pickpocket. They get on a crowded bus, bump into people, and steal their wallets. That's what I did to the English. I stole their wallet without them realizing.
Nearly every striker worth his salt, he will do the same thing. You are there and somehow you have to score a goal and you try to do everything. You try to do maybe a little foul, you try to do maybe a little hand. You will try anything to score a goal.
Had Gary Lineker done it and we'd won the World Cup, you know, of course he would have said, well, we don't really want to win this way, but we'll take the victory anyway.
On the streets of Buenos Aires, revenge against England tasted sweet. But the people had more to celebrate than Maradona's sleight of hand. Just 4 minutes after his act of theft, he had delivered a brilliant and fatal body blow, sending England crashing out of the World Cup.
And he's hurting England again here. It's a brilliant run. It's one of the world's great goals. And there's no doubt.
Completely and utterly despondent. All I could think of was my own family and the fans and you know, the players who had worked hard and that, you know, gee whiz, we're out of it, you know. We'd be knocked out. But I was angry as well. I knew, you know, we'd lost 2-1 and one goal was a bizarre goal and, you know, the referee let us down and you're just aggravated about it and you're helpless because there's nothing you can do. You've lost the game 2-1. The game's over. Referee's blown the whistle. You're out. World Cup's finished. Another 4 years.
In England, Maradona had become public enemy number one, the ultimate cheating orgy. Now it was the English fans who sought revenge. But when England and Argentina next met in the World Cup, it was not an Argentinian, but a young Englishman who became their target of hate.
David Beckham, you know, was maybe a little bit naive in what he did, but nevertheless, I think too much was made of it. I don't think he should have been sent off. It was a nothing incident, and the referee overreacted, in my opinion.
For English football supporters, the 1990s had been the decade of disappointment. Their team had failed even to qualify for the 94 World Cup finals. But 4 years later, the fans were smelling victory once again, and they were looking to a new hero, a young man eager to take them into battle.
We've come a long, long way together.
England progressed to the last 16 of the 1998 World Cup. But in France, it was the Argentinians who lay in wait for them once again.
And England, as you can see, in an all-white strip tonight, just as they were on that boiling day at Wembley in 1966 when Jeff Hurst's glancing header gave England such a wonderful victory over Argentina in the 1966 World Cup.
We knew we'd got a good squad, and we knew that if we could play well, we would have a good chance.
It was a good atmosphere that night. There were no animosity or, you know, it wasn't a hostile atmosphere. It was just everybody having a good time, and it was a nice warm night, and, you know, everybody were looking forward to a good match with that bit of edge to it.
Beckham to Scholes.
And the game did get off to an edgy start.
Anderton claims he got a smack in the face there, but the referee again saw nothing untoward.
But for England, it was not only edgy. It was a nightmare. With just 8 minutes gone, the Argentinian captain, Diego Simeone, set a booby trap.
Well, Seaman's just well. He didn't get these given a penalty. And a yellow card to David Seaman. The worst possible start.
I got conned into a penalty, so to speak, but, you know, I was silly enough to commit myself. Simeone touched the ball past me and went over.
He's just cleverly left his foot there. He's gone down, and from the angle the referee was, it probably looked like a penalty.
So Seaman would get to that one, and he looks bemused himself.
There's two ways of looking at this, and it is only a game. I don't think it is cheating. It just depends on your definition of what's right or wrong.
And he almost got to that, but it's 1-0 Argentina.
It was an easy way for him to get a penalty. You know, and I'm sure that our forwards, if they knew about that, you know, the way to do it, they would do it themselves.
Of the ball as well.
If England's forwards had still to learn, they did so very quickly.
And that sure is another penalty!
Just 2 minutes after the Argentinians' goal, the 18-year-old Michael Owen went down in the box and won the game's second dubious penalty.
Shearer with a chance to make it 1-1. And does it superbly! Danger in a flash and finds Beckham.
10 minutes later, Michael Owen penetrated Argentina's defences yet again.
It's a great run by Michael Owen, and he might finish it off! Oh, it's a wonderful goal!
For England, it was revenge for Maradona's devastating attack 12 years earlier. But the quality of the football was soon to be overshadowed. With the old enemies locked in a 2-2 stalemate, the real drama, the real controversy, emerged later as old habits refused to die.
You know, the Argentinians were quite niggly, as they always are, you know, going into tackles and leaving their foot in and pulling shirts and stuff. And there's an incident whereby David Beckham himself, I think, had been fouled.
Owen wasn't. I think a yellow card is going to be brandished here somewhere, and it might be to David Beckham.
I don't know whether Simeone said anything, but Simeone kind of like patted him on the back or whatever, walked past, and David Beckham tripped him.
He had his back to me, and I went in hard, but I didn't get the ball, and I think I kicked his leg. I don't remember it very well now, but I know I crashed into his back. When I tried to stand up, he kicked me from behind, and I took advantage of that. Anybody would do the same.
Now Shearer's telling Batistuta not to get involved. The two captains there. There's a yellow card. Wait a minute, he's taking another card out for Beckham. It's a red card for David Beckham. Oh, no. So Beckham is out of the game.
From on the pitch, I didn't see it. And it wasn't until afterwards that I'd seen it. You know, but I knew, because obviously he got a straight red, I knew something had gone on.
It was a little flick, which was a trip, which didn't warrant a sending off. Had he got up and punched him or kicked him really hard or violently did something, fine.
And it wasn't like a full blatant kick or anything like that. It was just a little flick, you know, and at the most it warranted a yellow.
I think in any other game it'd be at most a yellow card, but... I don't think the Argentinian players helped. I think they were milling around referee to maybe get him sent off.
They would see that as a good opportunity to put pressure on the referee, which they did. And if they think that's the way to act, to get one player off and to make it easier for themselves, they would do it. They do it. You can't say they don't, they do.
Here we are again. Down goes Simeone. He's obviously going to make the most of it. Well, he got a yellow card as well.
I thought a little bit about Ratting, you know, being sent off in a crucial match, you know, for what was really something that was a bit trivial, really.
Unfortunately, David had to go, and with that, obviously went our chances, although the team did play very well with 10 players, no doubt about it.
After Beckham's red card, England survived waves of Argentinian attacks for over 70 minutes. Still two each after extra time, the bitter rivals regrouped and prepared for a penalty shootout to the death.
Well, once we've decided who's taking the penalties, the first five, it's then deciding in what order they're going to take. And the gaffer light said to me, "You take fifth." And I just thought, I took it as a bit of a compliment in that I thought, well, it's probably going to be Farrell or whatever, and I'll score winner.
David Batty is coming forward for England, and he must score.
I can remember going out to the side and thinking, right, who's taking our one? And I can remember looking back and seeing David Batty coming up. And I just thought, hang on a minute, I've never ever seen him take a penalty, even in training.
If he fails to score, England are out.
It was a strange feeling, because I was like, well, he's offered, you know, he's said that he would take a penalty, so he must have done it before.
I'd taken one as a junior, and I shouldn't have taken that because I broke my rib in a game, and I could hardly run coming up to take it, and I missed that. And that was my only experience previous to that.
Argentina go through and England go out.
David Batty's penalty miss ignited scenes of euphoria in Buenos Aires. Victory over the hated English tasted as sweet as ever.